do what you have to do, your job, just fundamentals, stick to that. Long as you do that, whatever the problem comes in front of you, you will see it.
Hello, captains of armband. Welcome to another episode of Short Corners, where we interview footballers, managers, coaches, analysts, scouts, directors, and owners of various football clubs to bring different aspects of the game closer to you. Today, along with us, we have Mr. Gouramangi Singh Moirangthem, the former Indian football team captain and the current assistant coach of Bengaluru United. So, Mr. Gouramangi Singh, how have you been and what are your reactions on the Kolkata derby that took place yesterday?
First of all, thank you so much for having me here. And Kolkata derby anyway, a derby is always a derby, and I've been following the derby for many years since my playing days. And it's always exciting, and I think it went well yesterday. So I hope that the tradition continue. Both the team is supposed to be, or still is the, the kind of legacy, the kind of tradition that Mohammad Ismail Bengal carries, and I just hope and pray that both the team continue doing well and be competitive in the league. So. Best wishes to both the teams.
So now coming to our very own podcast, Mangi, you decided to leave your family to join the Tata Football Academy at a very young age. Now, arriving from a different state to a different background and having to stay there without your family or your friends, how did you deal with these socio-cultural and mental challenges that you had to face at such a young age?
Honestly speaking, I never, maybe today after almost 22 years back, I can look back and think about it. But when I got selected to join the Tata Football Academy, all these things about diversity, about living family, it was never in my mind or in our mind. I think from that, at that age, I think as a young boy, just happy playing football and everything, back in your mind is all about go there, play football, because you're so overwhelmed and happy and excited that you're going to the Tata Football Academy and you're going to spend years there learning football and try to become professional eventually. So that was the only thing in your mind. So you're really not thinking about how things going to be there. So once you start living there, then yeah, different things. But I think you embrace as it goes.
So your main focus was completely in football, and just you had to build your career from there on in. Now, in one of your previous podcasts, you mentioned that your time at the Tata Football Academy made you realize it was going to take more than just talent to succeed in football. So, what were some of the habits that you had to ingrain in your daily life and routine? And during that period, and you have still kept those habits so that it has helped you much more in life.
Yeah, as I mentioned in your first question, that there was only one thing in my mind, back in my mind, is all about playing football. And I was not thinking about leaving my family, leaving my friends. I wasn't thinking about how things are going to be in the Tata Football Academy or in the academy. It was never in my mind. It's all about so happy, overwhelmed, excited that you are going to join the academy, the best academy then, even today. So you're happy. So once you got in there, as you mentioned about like how to succeed, it's on the pitch, off the pitch. So you don't think about it, but as you enter, as you join, even from the first day itself, the situation itself or the ambience, the environment itself, made you think, made you realize from the first day itself that yes, you're here to play football. Yes, you're here to learn football. But for you to succeed and eventually become professional, there's a lot more than just playing football. That is what, I'll just give you one incident where I think I've mentioned earlier as well, where on the first day when I entered the academy, the lobby and the office, when I sit down with the Johnson, who was the warden then, handed me the joining letter. And since when I opened it, I was so happy I got it, and I opened it and I read and it was clearly mentioned that you're here, you're selected, and we welcome you here. You know, this is your home, but you're here for 6 months. You're on probation. So I was like, okay, as a young boy, it just hit my mind, back in my mind that, okay, I'm here. I have to prove that I'm getting better, I'm improving, and I have to earn the place to be there. So 6 months is where I have the time where for me to keep pushing for my place there, keep getting better, you know, try to be the best, you know, possible you can be. So the first day itself, so if I don't improve, if I don't get better in that 6 months, you know, the academy, the coaches have the right for them to rethink about the decision for me to bring in there. So that itself, I think I was like, okay, I wanted, I was excited, but it made me, that was the first thing, realized that, okay, so I have to do more than just playing football. Yes, I have to get better. So for you to get better as a player, getting better as a player, off the pitch, things that you have to do. So you start thinking about it as a young boy, as a 15, 16 years old, the situation force you to think that what are the other things for you to get better, for you to grow as a better player every day. So I think that was the first thing. So I cannot take each day for granted. So every day for me is about getting better and getting better. So what it takes to be getting better? So I start looking around, like as mentally, as physically, socially, emotionally, I have to find a way to survive there, because I like to play football. I love playing football, and that was the only dream. So for me, eventually to realize my dream, I have to do whatever it takes. So that's why I said, like, we talk about in football, about the physical, mental, emotional, social, everything, what it takes to become a better player and also a better person eventually. So that is what I think TFA taught me from the very first day, to make me realize that it's not only about playing football. It's about holistic development as individual, as a player, as a person. So, so those are the things. And also, again, reputation as Tata Football Academy. Then I remember in the first few days itself, I don't know if it's still there. Yeah, in one of the wall in the lobby, you would see names from all the ex-cadets who had represented the country or the current players from the academy. So this was from the first place, chairman by Randy, Balin, Deepak, Mahesh, Noel. So there's like, I don't know, tens of, or even, I don't know if already crossed hundreds, but it was tens of, like, there's huge, like the list of names. And I think it's quite inspiring when you see that, okay, eventually at some point I want my name to be there. So, because it's like, and you started after, you know, spending time there every day, training. And even I remember, like, when Deepak was there with his bengal and watching their games at the hostel. So it is more about that eventually one day I want to be like them. I want to be like him, or I want to be, I have my name to be there. So there's a lot of things that are going as a motivation, as a moral booster for you. But you have to first realize how much you want it, and to realize that what are the things that for you to improve, get better. So I think that is what TFA is all about. And I need to, like I said, I need to earn my place. I need to show that at that S group, I need to be better, and we need to be better as a group, as a team. So we need to win. We need to win more matches. As an individual, we need to get better. So I think that was all about the Tata Football Academy from the very first day.
Inspiration, motivation, and that thirst to prove yourself is what comes into your game. And now, in your professional career, Mangi, of nearly 15 years, you've played for more than 10 clubs. So why is it so important for you, or why was it so important for you to constantly push yourself out of your comfort zone and live in survival mode? Because 10 clubs, lots of changes in your in different clubs means changes in playing styles, changes in teammates around you. So what kept you going when, you know, transferring from one club to another and throughout your career?
I think very early in my career, when I started playing, when coaches in academy always used to tell us or remind us that if you're lucky as a football player, you will have probably like 12, 15 years if you don't get injured, or you're consistent with the performance and you're doing well, you might have that is 12 to 15 years or 10 years. That's a very short, I think, career. And everything's going very fast. So it's about how much you take it seriously. So each day was important for us. And so each day going out, getting up in the morning, going out to the field, try to compete, try to be the best you can possibly be again. And it's not about the day you feel that you're comfortable. I think that is the day where you're going down. So it's about, as a young cadet getting to the academy, you're thinking about, so what can I do to prove that we are better? So I think I still remember in 7 or 8 months, eight of us were part of the Bihar team representing Bihar for the sub junior. And we traveled as a Bihar, representing Bihar. And we went to Tirunelveli, which is down south in Tamil Nadu. And they didn't say it, like the coaches didn't say it very loud, clear, but indirectly it was very much clear the message to us that you go there and you win and you come back. If you don't win, that means there are the better players than you. So, yeah, so I think we are very young, but I think we are made to think that you need to work every day, you need to fight for your place every day. So we went there. I think fortunately, we find a way. I think we were together as a unit, as a team, as a team Bihar. We beat Bengal in the final, and it's like we're so happy. Not just because of winning we're so happy to win the trophy, the sub junior trophy, national for Bihar. We're so happy. But at the same time, back in the mind, eight of us were like, oh, this will give us more time, you know, in academy. I think it's just a message to the coaches that we are working hard, we're getting better, we are among the best for that S group. That's how we earn our first national, sub-junior national caller for the under-17 youth championship. That's how we, our names were there. I think among those 25-30 probables, that's how we got to be again part of the national setup in the 17 and the 19 and the 20. So I think each day, that's why I said, like, from the very early age, we were like pushed to situations where you need to find a way to come back. So I think that was the foundation for me, at least, and also I think for all of us, like even for all my batchmates, that we go there and no one is going to give us a place to come and sit there. No, because we have to earn that, we have to fight for it. So even you talk about the clubs, the 10 clubs that I played, I don't know, since you mentioned it, I never counted, you know, then how many clubs that I played for, but you go there and you have to fight for your place. When I join different clubs, there are already players there, so I have to go and earn my place, fight for my place. So I was never comfortable. Till my last day, I never knew that Neroka, when I played my first I-League games, I never knew that, okay, eventually I decided I just wanted to take it easy, and I think time to give more time to the family. But I didn't knew that that was my last game. I think it was Super Cup in Bhubaneswar. I didn't knew that it was my last game. But even till my last game, I wasn't comfortable. I wasn't sure that. So you finish 90 minutes, you think about it. When you come out from the pitch, what it's back in the mind is like, okay, have I done enough for the coach to select me for the next game? So even after playing for 10, 15 years, it's always back in the mind. Till my last day, I was like, have I done enough for the coach, give right hand to select me for the next game or not? So I think that was the mindset. That was how we, I think we work. And I enjoyed horribly. I enjoy every bit of it. And I love it. I can't be comfortable. I love, it's not about, I don't know, it sounds like a little too desperate about being on a survival mode, but you choose to be. I mean, no one forced me to play football, and I love it and I enjoy it. And I it was my decision to to play football, and whatever, you know, to succeed in something that I love doing it. And it was my decision, it was my choice, and I enjoy every bit of it. whether you are comfortable or not, because that's the sport's all about, right? Winning and losing, and it's part of the game. But it's fun to win. So, yeah, you try to keep your best in everything you do, every training session. Yeah.
So you actually went out there and played your heart out, did something you loved, and you did it for many years and very consistently as well. Now, during your career, you played for the likes of Dempo, Churchill Brothers, and also Sporting Club the Goa. These are the, the holy trinity of Goa at that time. Did these Goa clubs do anything special or different from the other Indian clubs to become so, so successful in that time, in that period?
I think sometimes what happens is, as a player, you join a club and you meet your colleagues, and it's all back in the mind that we want to become a strong unit and try to win as many matches as possible. So even, for example, as you mentioned about Dempo or Sporting, or even it's not gone, but in my first 3 years after I passed out from Tata Football Academy, even Mahindra. So when I joined Dempo, we won the cup, we won the league. After that, I went to Mahindra, we won the league, we won the cup. As a player, as a young boy, some 19, 20 years old, you're happy that your team is winning. You're happy you're part of that winning dressing room. Somewhere, you're a little disappointed because you wanted to play more, but you get to play as a young boy, trying to establish yourself in the senior dressing room. But today, when I look back, there are more than so much of positive, I think, so many things that I've learned, knowingly or unknowingly. I think the biggest things that I have learned from the two dressing rooms, even including Sporting, in that my formative years as a getting into as a senior player, what it feels to be in a winning dressing room and what it takes to be winning. Those years in Dempo, winning the league, winning the cup, and those senior individuals, those senior professionals, the Indian international, the foreigners, I think Barito, Yakubu, Odafa, I mean, I don't know, so many of them, like, I think Ranti, I think we all became good friends eventually, but all those names, the senior players, and how they carry themselves, how they prepare on the pitch or off the pitch, and just being around and winning, like they say, is a habit, so they like winning, and just to be around with them, just travel with them, sitting with them, eating, training with them. I think knowingly, even unknowingly, I have learned so much, and what it takes, that habit, I think, just to see them. Even like I said, even about thinking, I'm just watching them, and I'm part of it. And I think those formative years, just to be part of those winning teams, champion teams, even I think instill things which even I don't know, but probably that helped me eventually after some years. When I joined Churchill and we ended up winning so many cups and trophies, Duran, IFSC, Goa League, I League, just to be part of that, team, that winning team. I think that formation, that mentally or physically, all started, I think, years back from the academy to being part of that winning dressing room again in Mahindra or Dempo. So I think it's all accumulation of, the hard work from the years and all those effort. So then again, that is what I think what it takes to be to win, and also that part of the winning dressing room. But just quickly coming back to your questions, where what do they do differently from the rest of the other teams? I think that phase of, I think it's more to do because we're happy with each other. We're happy playing with each other. So I never felt to change the club. That I think I've spent 5 years, the longest time I spent was with Churchill. In those 5 years, I think the last time when Kolkata, both team, Mohan Bagan, East Bengal, and also even Mohan Sporting, were very dominant for years. And those period where I think 2003 was, if I'm not wrong, I think it was Mohan Bagan who last won the National League. Then after there was a gap of 10 years. And that 10 years, the Goa club, the Bangalore, or even Mumbai started winning all the, for the 10 years. And our generation was very much part of it. on all those winning those cup and league. It was nothing to do with, I think, the yes, like I said again, sometimes no matter how good your team is or how many good players do you have or how, you know who do you have as a coach, maybe the best coach you have, but sometimes the success are not guaranteed. But sometimes that combination of, I think it takes a lot of combinations, a lot of things to become a winning team. And when you started winning, even on the first year or the second year, you like each other as a coach, as a staff, as a club. And we all like to be with each other, playing each other, and we keep winning. So I never failed because I kept, remember, I every year, there is a Mohan Bagan or East Bengal reaching out to me, hey, come to Kolkata. I was like, I would like to at some point, but right now, I just don't feel that we're winning. Everyone's happy with each other. Everything's going well. What the point for you to, you know, just... it was not about... Yes, as much as the culture is there in Kolkata, the football culture, even in Goa, the cultures are very strong. So it's a footballing state. Kolkata is a footballing state. Even Goa, and I spent a lot of years in Goa, many years. Even I have a small home even today, and I love going, keep going back there. And the... So it's more to do with you are in that phase of your career where you're happy with your team, with your teammates, with your coaches, with your staff, and you keep winning matches and you're just enjoying. You're going, just going with the flow. So there was not really back in your mind that what, why not, you know, who treated you better or not. But I think we are just in the right place at the right time. Everything is going right for us. We're happy with each other. Keep winning. So that, I think that probably was not about who treated you better or what was the difference, but... I think it's more to do with that the group of individuals form that good unit and happy to work with each other. So I think probably that is the right way for me to put it. Yeah.
Now, you spent a lot of your early years in life in the Northeast. Then you've played your professional career mostly in Goa. Now you're coaching in Bengaluru. So is there any basic difference in these regions on how you approach football? And have you had any experience in that regard?
I grew up in Manipur because I come from Manipur, and the culture, the football culture is very, very strong. Not just football, but I think as everyone knows that Manipur is very much, you know, the sporting culture is very strong here. So I think everyone here at some point in their life, they play some sport. So I think that is very much there. So for me, growing up years, to get into something, you know, I played different other sports like as a young kid, and football is something I like the most, and I became football player. So that is one part. And also I have seen, because Kolkata is, I have so many friends there, and it's one city where I have to be always there. Either it's a transit or I played a couple of years there, so. It's one of, still even today, I keep saying that what I love about being in Kolkata is because even today, it's not, people say that, okay, with time, things have changed a little bit, but still, even in the dining table, even people still talk about football. People still relate to Mohan Bagan and East Bengal. I mean, I love it, honestly speaking. And anywhere, any Bengali, any part of the world I've met, they will still like, okay, they try to like, okay, that Mohan Bagan and East Bengal. And I think that culture, I just hope that for the next coming 100 years that has to be there. And I think people should, I'm sure it will, because that culture, and it's different, it's a little different, but even culture that in Goa, and why I love being Goa is also because even people love the game, people follow it, people play the game, people talk about it, people really discuss about it, and people just, given day, people just like to play the game as well. So similarly, I would say like Goa, Kolkata, even Manipur, there's a very strong football, you know, culture, state. But again, you back to your Bangalore. Why? Yes, even Bangalore, you won't believe, I think the last two seasons that I had there, three seasons where we played the Bangalore, the league, and the number of teams they have in the league, and also the amount of, maybe it's not as, maybe like in Kolkata you have like Super Division, A Division, this division. In Manipur, so we have like 1, 2, 3 liners in Goa, also so many divisions. You know, maybe even Bangalore also. Maybe it's not as strong as maybe Goa or Bangalore today, but I think they do also like they do also love this game. And even that's what I found out. Even earlier, I used to, what I do know about Bangalore is ITI or HL, or BFC later. So these are the teams whenever I go to Bangalore, just to play against these teams when we play for away matches. But when I go to Spain last 2-3 years there, and understanding, seeing the grassroots development, number of teams they have, and how much people love it, and I will not be surprised in the next few years, Bangalore even might become a very strong, even they are strong, but they will become a very stronger, football state again. So again, I hung my boot and I was doing my licenses, and Richard was the second instructor, assisting Savio sir in Bombay. And I was really planned to go there because I was busy with cargo here in Manipur, and I have my other family business as well. So I was quite caught up with a lot of things. But eventually, again, I want to understand this side of the game. I've spent so many years playing football, but this side of the game where the coaching side, it's about trying to understand the game more deeply. So I think towards the end of the third module or second module, I think Richard, I remember I was at home and Richard called me. I was like, hey, Mangi, this is one project I'm going to take up. And it would be great that if you can, join me just, pulling through this. I was like, my first question was like, why should I come there? And I've seen, I think, enough of Indian football in 20 years. And I want to work in the right environment more than any other thing. So I think he got it right. So probably he understood that. I think that is what is going to come from me. So he said, this is what it is. And the whole plan and everything. And so that's how I agreed that, okay, I'll join. And even it will be part of learning for me. It was, for both of us, it was like... first job, a senior job. He was so involved into grassroots development, the youth development for the AIFA, for the TFA, for the BFC, that he has done so well in youth career in that part of the job. And he just got this senior because he wanted to get into the taking of the senior job. And we couldn't qualify. That is a little, we are sad and we're a little disappointed, but I think winning BDFL League, and we have learned so much. I mean, we could deliver what we wanted, but we were just happy in a way that how we have come out as a team.
Even before making your national team debut, you captained India's youth sides and got an opportunity to train with Stephen Constantine's senior team setup. So how did these moments shape you as a person and also as a player playing for the national side?
Yeah, I think for that, I owe a big time to Stephen Constantine because I was very much part of the youth teams on the 17, 18, 20. And I think this was early 2004 before I passed out from Tata Football Academy. I was invited to join one of the senior team camp in Goa. The senior team was planning, they were planned to travel to Jakarta for a couple of friendlies, then from there directly go to Tokyo for the World Cup qualifying. So I was the only one as a young boy, and for me, I haven't played with any club, and getting that invitation to be part of the senior team. And if I remember, those boys are like someone, most of those boys, I mean, Bachungbhai, Mahesh, Renzi, Deepak, Sandeep, Sandeepbhai, all of them. I mean, they are like all those individuals. I look up to them even from the days in school. And going there, just to see them, training with them, I was like, I said again, I don't know what I was learning, but I think knowing and learning, I'm sure that I've learned so much being around with them. And Joba, I remember playing one of the starting one game against Indonesia. playing center back with Jobai. I was like, Jobai. I was like, just such an amazing, I mean, great, great person, great player. I was like, so much. I mean, trying to look back, I don't know what word will be just to describe that. But I was more than overwhelmed just to be there. And like I said again, I don't know what I was learning, but I'm sure I was learning a lot. And of course, I was learning to see them, just to, you know, very watching them, what they do, and you know, how do they prepare, and I think probably that helped me to grow as a player, you know, going forward.
Mangi, just a bonus question from my end. Just the first time when you got called up to represent India, what was the feeling? If you just walk us through that.
First time called up, honestly speaking, because you're talking about a youth team or you're talking about a senior team?
The senior team,
because if you talk about a senior team, because I was part of the youth setup for so many years. In all the age group tournaments, I was part of it. And I was just waiting for that moment where, when will I get the, I'm not a senior debut, okay? I was part of, like I said, as I just mentioned, it was 2004, early, I didn't get my debut, but I was part of that team, even World Cup qualifying against Japan in Tokyo, you know, just being around with them was such an amazing experience. I learned so much. But that was one part, but I never got my debut, official debut. Even that friendly was not an official friendly against when I got to partner with Jobai against Indonesia. I remember all those moments. I was like so happy. But I was waiting. I was waiting for my debut. I played. I had the experience to be part of these youth teams, but now I wanted to be part of the senior team. So my senior team debut was in Delhi against Syria for the Nehru Cup. So thanks to Bob for trusting me and giving my debut. So I remember, I think, first game, I don't exactly remember against whom. So, you know, it was not easy. I was waiting, but I don't know when my opportunity will come, because Deepak Bhai and Mahesh Bhai were so solid as a two center back. They have brought up from Tata Football Academy. They are my seniors. And watching them, growing up in academy, watching them in TV, and now I'm sharing dressing room with them. And now I'm waiting that when will I get my chance? So I'm waiting. And it was very unfortunate. It was in the second game, I think, where Deepak Bhai got injured. And that's how, I mean, I don't mean that. I'm so sorry for Deepak Bhai, but he was such a brilliant, I mean, person, he was a great player, as we all know. But I remember, like, Mangi, just go enjoy play, because he was out of the tournament because of his knee, some knock that happened. And I got an opportunity, start. Then I played it. I was like, I'm playing together with Mahesh Bhai. That's how I partner, and we ended up playing for a few years together with Mahesh Bhai. So I think that's how I call it. So I think those moments, something that it sounds a little dramatic, but I have to live forever, you know, with those moments. And hopefully, you know, in the future, if, you know, when I have my family and, you know, my kids, and I can just tell them that those moments, something that I can't buy with money, or, you know, it's just something, it's priceless. Those moments I was, super happy, excited, everything. Just moments. I'm playing for your country. I mean, that's the last thing. That's everything.
Yes, absolutely. That blue jersey, that India jersey, so much pride, so much honor. And I'm sure you'd be so much honored to have won that and played for your country for so many years. And now coming to your coaching career, in 2019, you joined Bengaluru United as an assistant coach to Richard Hood. And since then, the club has won back-to-back Bengaluru Super Division titles. So as an assistant coach, what are some of the things that you do exclusively to support the head coach? And how are they aligned to the bigger goal of the club?
I think even if you... Sometimes I was pretty clear. I don't know what was my role as an assistant coach. So, I'm not going by the books. I think it was more like an instinct. It was something that what I had experienced as a player. I've been to a couple of clubs, and I remember there was when the head coach and assistant coach, they're not getting along. Maybe the club, you know, hired them differently, or they are not a team, but they asked to work together. And I have seen when I was playing that head coach and assistant coach has a different vision of the team, or they're not getting along. That little friction, even if that little friction, I think the players can smell it. And that's where even the dressing room starts to get the little feel about it, and started to get a little crack, you know. You got it right. So everything starts because when the team is winning or losing, the players tend to see the coaches' faces. And particularly for the head coach, when you're winning, you tend to look. I think it's very obvious, not tend, but you'll go to look at the head coach's face. And so the head coach, maybe if you see that, like, you know, the coach is taking it really easy, then it just translate, you know, or transfer that vibe to the field, and you know, that's all those little things that. So it's very important that the players have to. I think for the staff, the biggest job is to making sure that we are a team. I think the moment we feel that we cannot work together, we shouldn't work together. So I think that was something that I'm not going by the books, but I made it very clear. Maybe there are times when I don't agree with Richard, and I think he knows about it. And we said, I don't agree about it. Then we go and we come back again. And I was like, okay, fine. We try to come to the halfway. I said, like, and I have to give a reason that, okay, this was something that I don't agree about. But yes, his head coach, it is vision, it is a plan. But in football, like we say in football, there is nothing right and wrong. There's no plan that is a wrong plan. It's just a plan how you execute it. And I think so. I think we as a staff, I think we as a supporting staff, we try to make it sure that his vision, so he needs to convince that this is the right thing to do about it. And we just have to support it. And we have to making sure that. But I think Richard has given me so much. I mean, I don't think so I would, starting my career as a coach, what Richard has given me, I don't think so I would get with anyone. Because in terms of the pitch, on the pitch, even we talk about, say, I'm going a little technical now, but like attacking, defending in transitions, we have four moments in the game, right? But attack, defend in transition, negative and positive transition. So it was my responsibility about the team defending, for example. Not just about one unit, it's about the entire team, about the set pieces. So even in the sessions, when there's 11v11 sessions happening, so I, in any part of the pitch, so like whether it's attackers, so if the defense start from the front three or the front two, so their behaviors, everything. So it's not about always addressing the team. It's about addressing individual, addressing units, addressing group, addressing as a team. So it was my responsibility to see overall about the entire. So I think that all those response, but I don't think, I mean, thanks to Richard for that, and he's a good friend, and I think he, although those responsibilities that he kept to me, you know, what he has given to me, I don't think so that, you know, I would have got it anywhere. So for that, I think I owe him a big time for the rest of my career. And just coming back to again, how do I support my role? That I said again that I want to be sure that, like, you know, that we have to work as one, as a unit. That is one that I have to be supportive, and I don't want to see, you know, that we have a different ideas, so we have a different vision, we have to be one, because I don't want the boys to see that, even if there's something that we don't agree, but we better go back, you know, go back to our room or meet up with a coffee and just try to sort it out among ourselves. That's one. And the second thing is what I've also, again, this is again what I've seen, that where you need to remember that I'm assisting him. So I can't be like, you know, there's, I think maybe it just happened in human nature that, you know, you feel jealousy about, like, you know, you're working as a colleague. Yes, eventually at some point I might become a head coach. I might work as a, or take up a job as a head coach in whatever level it is. But there's a time for everything. But you, if given your word and trust to someone that did your role, so I can't go beyond that bypass. I think that is something that I don't like about it. And I think I just made it. So I think that's how we work. And I think maybe that's what he knows, that that's how I work. The services knows me very well. So I will even say, I think both of you just try to work. I think you both are young and just take up this job and just work for it. And, because you can't. Can't be, there has to be one leader. So he was the head, but we tried to, like I said again, we couldn't get it what we wanted, but we learned so much and we have achieved some. We failed to qualify. That is where we didn't like it. But we grow as individual, we grow as team, we grow as a friend, as a, you know, so yeah, we learned so much from each other. Just to making sure that you need to know that what's your role as an assistant coach.
Well, as you said, that you have to make sure that there were no friction between you and Richard. So now for a team to succeed, like as you said, that the players must not see that. They must not see a coach being negative-minded, or that it will spread up amongst all the team. So now for a team to succeed, it's extremely important to have a set of values that in turn set the team culture. Now, we often say that if the culture is strong enough, then the players, they take up that culture and they become even stronger. And if that culture is weak, then it becomes like the new people. So what are the non-negotiable values at Bengaluru United that set the culture, and how do you maintain them as a group?
I think what works well for both of us was, because we both are different individuals, like Richard having this background of spending a lot of years developing, you know, in the youth development, being around in the game in Indian football for about 10 something years. Of course, I have spent as a player for so many years taking up this job. One thing that I think what works well for both of us was we believe in keeping it simple as much as possible. As you mentioned, the word non-negotiable. Culture, yes. Culture sometimes cannot build in a month or 6 months. So for that, you need some long-term plan for that. But you have to start somewhere. So even if it's a 5 months, 6 months, 1 year, you try to. But I would love to have it longer and make it very concrete, precise, that what exactly the culture you're talking about, that culture cannot build in a week or, you know, because there's a 20, 25 players coming from different backgrounds. And in between even season, you have some new players coming in and some players again leave the club. So that it's something like something you need to keep building every day. But that's one part. But the non-negotiable, which is so important, as you mentioned, that we try to keep things as simple as possible. So I keep saying to the boys, like I talked about that little technical, that 4 moments, they are fundamentals. They are fundamentals about defending, they are fundamentals about attacking, they are fundamentals about about transitions. So those fundamentals, even if you go and listen to podcasts, read books, listen to some of the top managers, coaches in the world, those fundamentals haven't changed anything. Those fundamentals are the same, haven't changed. The defending fundamentals for the last, I think, since the football started, people started playing football, haven't changed those fundamentals. It's only about, so we, I think, go back to that. And that is why I keep saying, even I'll just talk about the defenders, for example, defending. I just keep saying about just making sure that these are non-negotiable. These are the basic fundamentals about defending. So making sure that, just keep, try to remember this, keep remembering it. So as long as you do this, any problem that comes in front of you probably will be, either it's a solvable if the opponents are like way better than you, sometimes they force you to make so many mistakes. I know that's what football is all about. If the opponents are very better than you, but I think that is a different problem to deal with. If the opponent in front of you is quicker, faster, more technical than you, then it's a different problem. It's a different problem. I like that problem. That's a different one. But you not doing those non-negotiable things, those fundamentals, then that's a big issue then. So do what you have to do, your job, those fundamentals, stick to that. Long as you do that, whatever the problem comes in front of you, you will see it. And it will be easy for us to work on it, even you made a mistake. So like you said, the non-negotiables, long as you do that, any problems that comes in front of you, we can go back again. Even if we say, for example, if you lose the game, we can go back and we can exactly know, you know, which part of the, you know, plan didn't work, or what are the areas that we need to work, because we know that was the fundamental. But if you don't do that fundamental, even the problems that comes, it will be difficult to solve, and you will not know. So many problems will come in front of you that you don't know how to solve it, because you don't know. You're not sticking to that plan. You're not sticking to that basic. So that those basic things about either attacking or the transitions or defending, that was all non-negotiables. And sometimes, you know, as individuals, we make mistakes, and we try to make less mistakes. So teams that do less mistakes, or individuals that make less mistakes, they are the ones playing at the higher level. So it's all about, can you make less mistakes? That's why I keep saying that today you're playing the qualifiers in the second, in the early qualifiers. The difference between you as individuals and the one who's playing in the ISL today, it's a very thin line. It's not much. It's just that probably if you're making like 5 mistakes today, maybe the one who's playing right up there is making maybe 3 or 2. That is only different. So it's not about, even if you, the good thing is if you can identify the mistakes, then again, mentally, the more you do about it, the more you think about it, then you grow. You embrace a situation and you grow. You get better. So that's how those guys make less mistakes than they are the ones. So it's about how much you want about it, how much you want it, and how much and realizing it. So those are the non-negotiable, the fundamentals. I think it's our job as a coach to keep reminding and be there in every possible situation, and keep telling them, keep reminding them, and this is what it is, this is what it is. So keep working on that. So I hope the boys enjoy working with us, and I'm looking forward to work with them again in the future. So those are the non-negotiables.
In the last 2.5 years as an assistant coach, you had to manage foreign footballers as well as Indian footballers coming from different backgrounds and cultures. So how did you communicate to get your ideas through to them, and how did your process of communication change based on the character of the players?
I think irrespective of where you come from, are you a Indian or are you a foreigner, or you know which state you come from, I think eventually we all are there. Very knowing, consciously, it's you that you decide that you're okay to join the club and join the club to play football. So all of us, I think, the language of football is pretty much the same anywhere in the world. So we don't have to talk much. Yes, we have to communicate during the game about, like, there's a man behind you, there's a man on the right or left, or, you know, delay, or, you know, all those. I think it's pretty much the same. So it's not the first time that a foreigner is coming in, or having a team from players from, I mean, I've been part of a dressing room, so we have players from different part of the country, and also players from and also the foreign players from the other, you know, in different part of the world. So I think it was not any new and any difficult task, because we all are there to play football. One goal is to play football and try to win many matches as possible. So it was not very difficult. But yes, as individuals, we have a different thoughts, we have different beliefs, we have different way of doing things. So first and foremost, like you said, again, you talk about those non-negotiables. Those are the you know, because that those are the moments, those are the most important moments of the game, and what you do with the ball and what you do without the ball. So we try to, I think every coach has a different belief and different thoughts and different philosophy, but I think we are also pretty clear about how we want, but how we execute and make it a successful one, it's that's a challenge as a coach, right? And make the team win matches is a challenge. But I think in the training sessions, we are pretty clear about what do we expect from them. And those non-negotiable is something that we try to, like I said again, it's not about always sitting, making that 25 players sitting in a room and talking about it. I don't think so. It's even difficult to even convey or pass on your message. So addressing, I think we have a very clear the communication with among our staff, like even not just me, but the goalkeeping coach, even assistant coach. So how do you address or reach out to players as individuals, as a unit, as a defenders or the midfielders or strikers or the wingers, or as a group, or depends on the situation. So I think we did all right. We developed to understand and find a way to communicate with the boys.
Mangi, you have co-founded KAGO Football Arena and KAGO Football Training Center. So what was the idea behind this, and what are your future plans?
I think towards the end of, because I never got the opportunity about K with Cargo, for example. Cargo basically means it's like my partner, Karan. So, you know, we didn't know what to really name whatever we wanted to do. So that's why it's current, the first two letters like and Go, it's Gouramangi. So I was like, okay, like, Cargo sounds like some fun to fun to pronounce for the people. So, okay, let's make it the Cargo. So this was when I was in Naroka in my last playing, you know, career. I mean, last playing season. I was home. Otherwise, I was out in Goa or Kolkata or Shillong, Bangalore, wherever. So I got to spend some time home. And I was like, seeing the situations here, we never had a foot. There's always a like small seven-a-side tub, you know, for people to come, for the leisure, you know, to play for fun. We never had one here. So I didn't know that people, because we have so many open fields here, I don't think the people would come to even pay and play. I didn't know that. So we bought a, you know, we know each other for long. It's like all football fans, and I don't know how long I'll be here as well, but we decided, okay, fine, man, let's put some money in the this build and see that. And I think it went well. So we are the first one to bring I think those artificial 7-a-side turf here. And I think people really enjoyed the first couple. Now we have, I think, numbers of the 10, 12, 15 number. I think we have a lot now here, I think. At least we happy to say that I think we brought that little, you know, we brought that culture here, you know, for people to be more active, you know, to play. Sometimes people get bored to see the huge field, and you know they've can't play this 11 aside. So people need to play all those for fun in the evening, like, you know, 5-a-side, 7-a-side, 8-a-side. So the culture is very strong now here. People do enjoy playing, and that's what's happening here. That's one part. And the second part is the training center, because I think it's a way of giving back for me. I think it all started, I think, after we met Turf. I was warm. I was like, it was summer. I was like, okay, let's have some kind of summer camp. I want to see how the kids. So we had summer camp. It all started there. I wanted to do it something, this academy thing, maybe later on. But I wasn't planned. I don't know if I was ready or not, but I was doing my B license, and I wanted to also, you know, whatever I got to learn in the license and also my experience. I thought, like, okay, you know, it'll be fun. I want to see that. Even this was some idea of Sabir as well, that if you want to get into coaching, just make sure that you, how much you enjoy being with the boys or girls, and see that, how do you like it? Or if you don't like it, I don't think so, you shouldn't even push yourself in there. Because you don't like it. Maybe that's not my thing then. So we planned for a summer camp. That was like good response. And since then I could stop this, because I think that's my challenge now. So the parents sort of like it. They want to continue. They want to see that then that's when I reach out to other aspiring young coaches. You know, it's a platform for them also to learn or to be around with the boys to understand what coaching is all about. So we have about 7 coaches now and all looking after different age groups. So the now challenge is things get serious, and now some of them, some good talents now, I think it's a moral responsibility as well that I need to provide a platform for them. At least they get to compete with the best possible team or individuals, at least in Manipur to start with. Because of the COVID, there's no youth league for the I-League, and that's why unfortunate. Otherwise, I was planning to play the youth league. And so what I did was, recently what I did was, Cargo is a company that we got into different other business as well. So it's just a company, and I need to form a club. So a club in a sense that this is why I formed the Imphal United. So we have this FC Imphal that I just formed recently. So now all the boys will be playing any tournament that we are trying to work on the calendar for the season, that how many tournaments they can play. And so working for those, so from going forward from now, they have started playing anywhere they go officially. So they will register themselves in the CSR, in the for the AIFF, in the portal. And at least so I'm happy that if they're good, then they can't be hide. So someone will notice them. Either if not us, then, the other team's coaches or the manager or the scout will notice them. So I think at least individually they are good, then I can, some extraordinary boys, it's just one call away for me. I can ask anyone. I think most of my friends or colleagues are also involved in different parts of the, clubs in the country. So, if they're good, then I want to help them. If I reach out to them that, hey, just see this boy for a week, I cannot ask them to select it. But if they're good, then they're good. If not, not. But just individually, I think I told them that, you just work hard. If you're good and you're good, I cannot hide. But if you're not good and if I ask someone, I cannot, that's not, so. But as a group, as a team, this is Imphal United is your team now. So any tournament you play, just try to go there and try to win as many matches as possible. And that's how you earn respect from your opponent and other teams. When you start winning, because I sounded a little strong, but I think I want to prepare them. I told them, you're 17, 18 now. So once you go to any other club, you need to earn your place. So I'm telling you that we are in the business of winning. If you win, that's how you earn your respect when you win. When you beat the other team, the other team will start, come to you and maybe handshake. And that respect is how you earn. So you need to earn, you need to win more matches, as most as possible. So that is the whole idea about that training center, is all about the giving back. So trying to, whenever I said, just keep working, listen to the coaches. Whenever I'm home, I'm in town, I'll be there and I'm always there. So I go out to them, spend some time, ended up taking up 3-4 sessions with my other coaches. Start at 5 in the morning and it goes on to 11, 12 in the afternoon. So, but it's fun. So I hope that we are doing something right. I hope that we are giving something for the boys, at least trying to show some pathway for them, encourage them to be positive, encourage them to work hard, because there's no shortcut. So at least trying to help them think the right way, to strong mentally. But that cannot happen just overnight. They have to work every day, every single day for that. So trying to do a little bit, I think, in a way, just giving back to the game, which has given me everything. Whatever I am, I'm here today, it's just all because of football. And I think that's the best way I can stay close to the game and give back to the game.
Yes, this is a very good initiative that you have taken, and all the best for the future plans there. And as you said about those football arenas, these are also popping up, in many places in Kolkata. And even me and my friends, we go when we have time and, just, as you said, 5-7 side matches. So it really helps. It really feels good also. And since the turfs are much more plainer than the normal fields that we have, it's much more fun to play there.
Yeah.
So,
true.
Coming back to your playing career now, during your playing days, you have lifted the National League thrice and Federation Cup twice. In 2009, you were named the best I-League defender of the season. In 2010, you won the AIFF Player of the Year. Now, even as a coach, you are helping your team win silverware. So at this current stage of your life, how would you define success and failure?
Well, we're talking about football, right? About in football, yeah. So I think it all started from the from my formative years, from my days, early days at Tata Football Academy, that the coaches made us realize from the very, very beginning in our formative years that no one is going to come and give you a place. It's something that you have to earn. And the, also, the coaches keep reminding us that if you don't get injured, you can have a career of, if you're lucky, you can have a career of 12, 15 years. And you cannot play football for your life. All life you cannot play. So I think we became conscious, we became serious, we became more love for the game, you know. So, of course, we love this game. That's why we start. We play. We decided to play the game, and the so sometimes everything cannot be always defined with winning and losing. Cannot be always defined with failure and success. But like I said again, if you want to earn some respect from your opponent, then you have to beat them. I think that's how I define. I decide to define success. I would say. So it's like. When you're in academy, you have to prove to your coaches that you're better than the rest. You're better than, you're at least working hard to be better, maybe among the better ones. And also again, then you dream about, like you dream about that, I want my name to be there in the probable list for the youth teams, for example, for the Indian team. When you got it, when your name is there, when you go to attend the game, and you think about, okay, I want my name to be in the final squad in that 18 or 20. And while you are in 20, you want to start the game now. Right, and now you want to be among the starters. So once you started the game, then you want to be among the, of course, you want among the better performers then again. And because, but you don't plan, honestly speaking. But you talk about those best defender or the I-League, I don't know, that player of the year. I don't plan for that, but I want to be, like I said again, it's fun to be part of the winning team. It's fun to be part of that winning matches. Like you, that's the only way you can earn respect, I would say. That's the only joy of playing football is when you win matches. That feeling is something that you cannot describe easily, or you cannot even describe with words. Of course, you're happy, but I think it was more than happy. I don't know what the right word for that. It's just, so it all depends on match to match. Some matches are so emotionally connect and you're so into that you really wanted to win that match. And when you win that match, you're like, I don't know, you just forget that you lost 2-3 kilos of water, you know, and you're just like so happy and you feel like done. But again, it's not over there. And in 3 or 4 days, you have another game again and you have to mentally prepare for that again. So I think it all started from the very beginning, you know, our days in the academy, to make us realize that that you cannot take things for granted, that no one's going to give you a place, you need to earn it, and the only way to earn is by winning matches. And when you, and also making us believe that it's not an individual game, it's a team game, so you need to be a team player. That is what exactly even I try to tell the boys in our academy, in our training center, that I see some boys, like we have equipment, right? We don't have a kid boy. You all are 16, 15 years old. You finish your training. Can you just pick up your bibs or the balls or the cones or markers and put it in the storeroom? Who's going to do that for you? So now if the coaches ask you and you are forced to do it, you feel like you're forcing to do it, then I think it's wrong. But what I'm saying is, this is a little habit that you need to develop here. That's why you're here. That's why you're training here. So, and what I said, like, do it now. Make it a habit now. Make it a part of your system then. Why I'm telling you is because after you're 18, 17, 18 now. So once you go to the senior team, when you go there, any club, when you join any club, there will be officers will be there. There will be management. There will be senior players. There will be players who are already there. So you are just walking into a new dressing room. But when you have this, all these little, you know, attributes or a little you know, qualities in you, even off the pitch, just picking up the cones, just being, be helpful, be a team player. So what happens is when you, if you, it's already part of you, then for you, it'll be easier to adapt in that, in the, in the dressing room. Even the senior players will see that, you know, they will embrace you quickly than even you thought, even you think. So you got it right. So those little things, little values that you need to develop here. So it's something that we, I think, because of TFA, we were very much fine. I think, you know, taught by our seniors, taught by our coaches, these are just, you have to be part of this. So I think I've said enough. So it's not about that no one is going to give you a place. You need to earn it. The only way to you earn it is try to win as many matches as possible. That's how you earn respect from other coaches, your opponents, your fellow teammates. And, you know, earn that love from the fans as well. There is some fans that follows you. That's how you earn their respect. It's the only way to win. Yes, sometimes it's not always possible to win, because there will be times when you lose, but that's when you go back and think about it and work on it, where the areas that you have to get better. So I think that's, I keep saying football is the best job, and I love every bit of it. But today as a coach, I love every bit of it. Yeah. So
coming to this Indian football setup, nowadays Indian football is going through a lot of turbulent times, like with the ISL going on and the I-League. Just talk about merger. There are many clubs shifting. So we'll not talk about the turbulence, but I'm going to ask you that, do you think that anything can remain constant or stagnant in such turbulent times, let's say in the coming 5 to 10 years in Indian football?
I think it's a human nature. I think the association with the human and the change, I think it's going to be the change and the human. I think it's going to go side by side always, right? So we'll always see some changes. But yes, I think the changes, if the changes is happening only to make things better, then I think that should welcome. So I don't think so that anything can be constant, because there'll be always some adding up, or there'll be something taking you off. So it's because we're always trying to get better, right? As a human, as I think it's a human nature that we're always trying to get better. So for the Indian football, I talk about about the mergers and the clubs, some clubs dropping out, some clubs coming in. I think it is not a new story in football, not just in India, but anywhere in the world. But this is going to be there always. And but the only thing is how we can take advantage of it, and how we can get the benefit out of it. So I think the focus should be always to the positive, I would say. Yes, if the negative is so much that it's dominating the positive, then I think probably we need to change the pathway. But yes, there's a majority. The major part is the positive, and there will be some, you know, small part where it's negative. Then yes, we need to balance it out. I think, because you can't be 100% like only good. I think then I don't believe it. There'll be some areas where, you know, some people might not like it, the ideas or things might not. But yes, if that's not harming the whole major idea, then I think it's all right. So if you talk about even the ISL today, I think it's what, 8-9 years now, and the so far I think yes, there's more positive than the negative. Slowly it took time, but now clubs are playing, the champions clubs are playing in the AFC champions, Champions League qualifiers, playing in the AFC Cup, slowly coming down to the foreign, the players' numbers, going by the AFC criteria, the rules. We get to see, yes, last two years has been tough for everyone because of the COVID. There's no fans in the stadiums yet. That's very unfortunate. But hopefully, as you mentioned earlier, also that we all can come back to normalcy. I don't know when it's going to come. But yes, that's a completely different topic. But seeing a better quality football, seeing a better turf, seeing a better stadium, if the clubs are looking after, well, the players, the staff, the coaches, and the clubs are also focusing on the youth development. I think those are the, these are the, I guess these are the, not the fundamental, but these are the foundation to have a successful football ecosystem, right? So in the ecosystem, I think these are, you know, because everything, what's happening on the pitch is so important, because everything's all revolved around that. So the players, the coaches, the staff, the youth development, because that's a supplier, right? So all these things are, the focus has to be always that. And the rest is all supports, basically the support staff. So we all need everyone, you know, it's a combination of a lot of things to make it successful. So I hope that I don't see anything we can expect to remain constant, but yes, we need to, if there need to be some little adder, something to be removed, then I think we should do, and we should keep on, because with time, things are changing, right? We never had this. Today we're having this podcast or interview here on internet, but 15 years back, I don't think there was anything, or the kind of access that we have or the information around us is, it wasn't there, like dead. So things are changing, so we cannot stop this change, right? So things has to be, has to be some, yeah, we need to adapt, and we need to keep on moving. Yeah.
That was beautifully put, Mangi. I don't think anybody else could have summed up what Indian football is going through as well as you did just now. Final question, Mangi, is that is there any advice that you will like to give to aspiring footballers and coaches?
To the players, just be honest with yourself. Yeah. Just be honest with yourself in whatever you do. And there's no shortcut. So be sure that, you know, at least you know that you're giving 100% or not. You know that you could have pushed a little bit more. If you think that, then you just push it. There's no two-way about it. Just you don't have to even think about it. If you feel that you need to, you could have pushed more, just push that. That means like there's some small percentage where you could have done more. So that, for that, I think no one can, I think there's no any instrument where you can, or any mechanism where you can measure that. So you know yourself how much you have given. So it's more than 100%, but it's 100%. So you just, I think we all just need to be honest as a young boy. And also learn to develop the self-awareness. I think we all as an individual have our weakness and strength. Right, some people are born with more speed, some people are born with a little more strength, some people are born with a little more technical, but you need to know your strength, and you need to develop your game based on your strength, right? So if I was a center back, I was not the strongest and not the fastest, so probably I, even if I have to spend 10 years working on that, my strength and speed, probably I will never be the fastest and never be the strongest, but I need that part of that quality in my game, but probably that will never be my game. So probably I have to work on understanding the game better, reading the game better. That's one area probably I can work and improve faster than try to develop my strength and speed. Yes, I'm doing it every day, but probably that will never become my strength. So I think for the boys or the girls, anyone you know, in their, you know, growing up years, trying to understand the game. So identifying your strengths and weaknesses, and try to develop the kind of football that you want to play. So be based on your strength. So I think that's maybe too many advice now, but I think probably that's something that I keep telling to the boys and girls and young aspiring players.
And to the coaches, any advice for the coaches, aspiring coaches?
I'm just starting my career as a coach, so I don't think so that I can give anyone any advice. Even I myself just trying to understand the game better. I'm learning every day, watching more games. Yeah, maybe sometimes I do believe that whatever 20 years of my football association somewhere or the other, I'm sure that I've learned something. So I cannot note it down or write it down, you know, on a book. But I'm sure when the time comes, maybe my reaction on the match day or my reaction on the training, I'm sure. I think I'm just trying to find somewhere middle way that what I'm learning now through the licenses, to the books, to the podcast, and also my experience on the pitch for all these years as a player. I'm trying to learn, so I don't think so I'm in the right position to even advise someone, like any aspiring coaches, because I think we're all on the same board. So, but yes, I think all the best to all the aspiring coaches, and I think it's fun because we are here just all because we love this game, and I think as long as we are honest with this game, I think we'll find our way through.
A quick shout out to our merchandise partner, Midfield Merchandise. If you want to buy quality 100% cotton t-shirts, stickers and lapel pins at affordable prices, Midfield Merchandise is the place to visit. Upon applying this coupon code, you will get a special 30% discount on your purchases. The link to the site and the coupon code are also given in the description below.
Well, this is time to bring an end to our podcast. So, Captains of Armband, that was all for today. We need to end our session here. Thanks, Mangi, for being with us today. To all of our viewers, thank you for tuning in. You can support us on Patreon. The link to our page is given in the description. Until next time, it's goodbye from Armband.